Welcome to our second workshop on the Faith Plants program. I'm saying good afternoon, but I realize that for some of you, it might be very early morning, so good morning. And for others, it might be good evening, so good evening, and thank you for joining us. In this workshop, we are looking at mobilizing your assets for people and planet. And we have some wonderful speakers here with us. We have Nana Francois. We have Bishop Frederick Hsu, who is joining us with a video recording, and James Buchanan, and their bios will be in the chat box very shortly. For now, we would love to get an idea of who we have here joining us. So please feel free to introduce yourself in the chat box. Tell us where you are, where you're based. Tell us if this is your first time coming to a Faith Plants workshop, perhaps what you'd like to get out of this workshop. And let us know if you are currently developing a faith plan, or perhaps you've already developed a faith plan. So we're very excited about this particular workshop. It's a very interesting topic. It's a topic that perhaps some might find slightly daunting, slightly challenging. So we certainly hope that you find it beneficial and of use and very informative, and that you leave this workshop with lots of key information on what it means to mobilizing your assets, and particularly in terms of mobilizing your financial assets for people and planet. So I'm going to start this workshop with a very brief overview of the Faith Plans program. I realize that some of you may already be aware of what the program is and what the program hopes to do. But for some of you, this may not be the case. So forgive me if you already know what Faith Plans is. Bear with me for a few minutes before I hand over to my colleague, Nana. So the Faith Plans program was officially launched last October 2021, but it builds on a longer program of faiths committing their own traditions and using their assets for the benefit of people on planet. The Faith Plan builds on the success of the original 2009 faith commitments. This was a program that was initiated by the Alliance of Religions and Conservation. And what was fantastic about this program is that it resulted in over 60 plans that have shaped the faith's response to key environmental issues and led to the creation of some new organizations that are doing fantastic and groundbreaking work in the area of faith and the environment. Those organizations include the Sikh environmental organization EcoSeek, Bhumi Global, and the Deist Ecological Temple Association. So the Faith Plans program builds on the idea or the acknowledgement that faiths are key stakeholders in the future of the planet and in ensuring a safe and sustainable planet for all. And now is the time to harness that role as faiths, as major stakeholders. To echo a quote from our colleague, Director of Movement Building, Dr. Lorna Gold, she emphasized that it's not just about the role of faiths as advocates for a better environment and a better world, but it's also about their role as asset holders. It's about putting the assets of faith at the service of climate action and environmental action. So essentially what this recognizes, and this is what's at the core of Faith Plans, is that faith organizations of all of the world's major faith traditions all around the world are major stakeholders, and they have the capacity to use their assets, and I'll explain more about that in a few moments, for the betterment of people and planet. So what is different about the Faith Plans program? The Faith Plans program, you may think, is quite similar to lots of other environmental initiatives that involve, you know, ticking the boxes on various environmental actions that faith organizations can take. But what's unique and what's fantastic about the Faith Plans program is that it offers an integral process that starts with faiths and their own context, and it builds from there. The Faith Plans program is holistic. It takes into account the full faith tradition and the full range of assets that sits within the faith context. It's solution focused, and then it's adaptable to fit within the specific local context, local needs, the organizational context, and then the faith context of the particular faith group. Faith Plans puts faith at the center, and from there, faiths then work with seven key areas of the Faith Plans program and plan environmental actions or activities around those key areas. So faith plants is about recognizing the various assets, but beyond that, the various maybe non-tangible assets that faith communities have. So for example, when we talk about assets, we include our buildings, we include schools, hospitals, land, and so on. But it's much broader than that, to also include lifestyles, media and influence, partnership, celebration, education and youth. And what the Faith Plants program aims to do is to encourage faith groups, participating faith groups, to ground their faith plan within their faith wisdom, within their faith theology, and what their theology says about caring for the environment and caring for each other. And then to use that context to broaden out and to develop a plan, a long-term plan, that helps them respond to these different areas within these different assets. So when you join the Faith Plans program as a faith community or organization or a network, we encourage you to start off with a holistic audit of your assets. So as I mentioned already, Faith Plans is based on 7 key areas: wisdom, assets, education and youth, lifestyle, media and influence, partnerships and celebration. And we invite participants to undertake an overview of what they've done already, to celebrate what they've done already. And in many cases, faith groups have been responding to the ecological crisis that we find ourselves in for decades and much longer than that. So we encourage groups to undertake an audit to get a sense of, well, what have we done already? And then from there to identify, how can we go further? How can we step further up to the plate? How can we be more ambitious, particularly in this decade that is so crucial really for as a turning point in preventing ecological collapse. In this particular workshop, we're looking specifically at assets, but particularly on financial assets. So you'll see on that that second column next to wisdom that's highlighted in pale green, we're looking specifically at financial assets. In other workshops, we will look at other areas. For example, next month, we're looking at land and forests. Just to give you an idea then of the process and the timeline for faith plans, and again, I'll touch more on this, I'll go into more detail on this throughout the workshop. So we are encouraging faith communities to commit to a 7 to 10 year plan that carries us through this really crucial decade. Faith Plans then provides a platform of support that faith groups engage in as they journey through the program. We also encourage active learning and sharing among faith groups so that you're not necessarily learning from us, but you're learning from each other. And we're realizing that that's very, very important for faith groups on the ground. And then what we do then, we offer a number of resources, and I'll go into that in greater detail. But we also then encourage faith groups to showcase what they're already doing, and then to share with us their final plans, which we upload on the website, on our faithplans.org website. And we're finding that that's a source of inspiration. It's also a source of ideas and learning and engagement for other faith groups that are joining the program. In terms of the year ahead, there are a number of key moments, big moments, that we're quite keen to amplify the momentum, the level of momentum around faith groups and environmental action and sustainable development. So for example, at the Stockholm Plus 50 Summit, which is happening this June to mark the 50th anniversary of the first UN conference on the environment, we will be there to showcase what's already happening in the space of faith and ecology and faith in the environment. And then we look then towards the end of the year in the lead up to COP27 in November, again, to use that as a moment to show what is really happening, to show the level of energy and momentum within the space of faith groups and environmental action. And then this is where we bring in the investment side of things. As we develop the Faith Plans program and as more plans come into the program, Faith Invest, which is the organizer of the Faith Plans program, will help to source and identify faith-based investment opportunities that can then be implemented. So I'm about to hand over now to my colleague, Nana. Nana is Director of Investment Solutions here in Faith Invest. We will be breaking out into breakout sessions, and Nana will let you know more about that as we move through the workshop.
Catherine, thank you very much for that introduction. And everybody, thank you so much for joining us today at the workshop on mobilizing your assets. As Catherine said, the faith plans really is around faith groups making their commitments over the long and medium term to address the current crisis that we face and to set up plans across everything that they own, everything that they manage, to really deliver a good future for people and planet. And I do just want to pick up from there, because the quote from my colleague, Dr. Lorna Gold, was very important, that faiths have a role. They are stakeholders, asset holders, and they have assets that can be mobilized. I will start by sharing a presentation. And it really is, as Catherine said, about starting from the faith values and holistically building from there. So as we think about mobilizing assets in this context, I want to first of all start off just with addressing something that I think is fundamental and important, because we all have different definitions of assets, and assets can be broadly defined and are broadly defined in many faiths. What is an asset? Dictionary definition can give us some sense of what it is. It is something that is owned or controlled. It's a useful thing. It has value to deliver current and future benefits, available to meet debts, or commitments, or legacies, or critically mission. And it's that sense of that broad definition of an asset, which is reflected in things like our money, our buildings, the land that we manage, the hospitals that we run, the real estate that we invest in, the educational institutions that we're involved in. These are all assets that can be mobilized for the good of people and planet. And how can that be, and what can assets really do for faith groups and for people and planet overall? Assets can sustain institutions and organizations and programs. Assets can be used sacrificially to give and to grant and to support things which wouldn't otherwise grow. And assets can also be invested to spark new enterprises and new hope. And that's very much what we hope will happen as part of the result of the Faith Plans program, that groups will understand how their assets can be used to spark new enterprises and new hope, and also generate some of those new opportunities through the Faith Plans program. And why do faith assets matter? It goes back to that role of faiths with their influence as stakeholders, the means that they have as asset owners or asset holders, and the real potential through assets. So that through the medium of assets, you can really move from beliefs and values into mobilizing out assets and getting faith consistent outcomes in what you do. So with that introduction, let's get into the heart of the presentation. Many faith groups do have values that are written down on paper, statements and positions on things that they are for and things that they are against across the context of all of their work. And many faith groups have, to some extent, translated these beliefs into policy statements and guidelines that are officially governed pieces of paper, officially governed documents that the laity can see, that everyone can see, that ultimately determine which investments are made, more often focused on the negative than the positive, but that do determine what can be done. But when we talk about faith-consistent investing, the point that we're making here is that as you look at your faith values, starting in that foundation, and look at the assets that you have, the key with faith-consistent investing is that you're really integrating your faith values and beliefs across all your assets. So it's not a carve out to one aspect of what you do. It's about intentionally aligning across everything that you control, have access to, and can use and mobilize for the good of your people and planet. And that is the key, being consistent across everything that you have. So when we put that in the context of a faith plans picture, it's very much around faith plans stating your mission based on your values, and then asset plans bringing that mission to life through the way that you mobilize those assets. Which means that in the very simple and a high level view, what do faith asset plans do? How do they look? They look at the assets that you have. They take into account the role that you have as stakeholders, asset owners, and the specific potential you have through your assets. You can, in order to invest in your own potential and your own mission, and also to create opportunities for others to invest in the projects that you generate as part of their mission. Bearing in mind that assets can be used to sustain you, they can be used sacrificially to give to other projects and opportunities, and they can spark new hope and enterprise. So at a high level, an asset plan would cover these areas. What do we have? What influence do we have? What do we own? What do we want to invest on our own mission? Where can we create opportunities for others? And how can we think about our assets overall as things that can sustain, can be given, but also can spark new hope? from that level of a faith assets plan, the investment solutions team, which is what I head up, then starts to get into the detail of how do you really translate some of these plans into specific investment action. Because you go from your mission into your plans, and then as you go into the plans and you try to implement them, that's where you get into the focus of investment solutions, how you put together policies and guidelines that govern the plans. Governance that keeps the laity and keeps the leadership fully involved and monitoring and connected to the plans. And then communication, which is really sharing the message of what you are doing with your assets and how they are making a difference for people and planet. And from an investment solutions point of view, we really split the work into two areas, which I'm sure we'll talk about later on. We talk about faith consistent investing as a whole, aligning all your assets to your faith values and beliefs. And then we particularly pick up on impact investing, because this is often the area which is most mission aligned for faith groups. This is where you're giving maybe sacrificially or maybe sparking new interest into things that it genuinely wouldn't happen without your faith's contribution, without your insight into what is needed in order to support people and planet. So that is a short introduction to the whole concept of faith consistent investing, how it relates to the plans and how it relates to asset plans. And it would be good at this juncture just to get a bit of a sense of how people respond to what we have shared. There will be a poll coming up just to ask a little bit about what have you heard, what have you learned, and what key areas you would like to focus on in the context of this workshop, because we're aware that many groups come from different levels and different experience. Some of you have done this before, some of you are well on the journey in terms of actually investing assets in a faith-consistent way, and some are very much starting. So happy to see feedback and responses to the polls. Do feel free to add your responses. And it's interesting to see in terms of early responses. Now, polls do change over time, as you all don't know. But in terms of early responses, roughly half of the groups do seem to have made a start in this direction. And that's very good to see. And that's encouraging to see, because we know that what we're doing with this program is really galvanizing what already exists. As Catherine said, we're sharing existing knowledge, but we're also bringing others along in this journey, because we feel that the faiths collectively, with their different voices, but all the stakeholders, can really make a meaningful impact in the next 5 to 7 years by the way that they commit. So thank you. And I think we'll come back to some of the results of this poll later on when we have a further breakout session. What I might do now is just introduce us to a couple of groups who have made beginnings and frankly a lot of distance and a lot of journey in the area of faith consistent investing. But first of all, going to start off with a video from Bishop Shu talking about the Evangelical Lutheran Church's journey into faith consistent investing, which started many years ago. And then after that, we'll invite James Buchanan from Operation Noah to also share what he's doing with churches here in the UK.
Welcome, everyone, to this insightful session that we're going to have with Bishop Shu from the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Tanzania, Northern Diocese, and some of his colleagues to tell us something about how to create a good financial investments and assets plan, what they've done, how they made it work, and what their plans are for the future. I would firstly like to invite Bishop Shu to introduce himself and introduce the colleagues who he has with him.
Thank you, Nana. Glad to be here. I'm Frederick Shaw, and I'm Bishop of the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Tanzania and the presiding bishop of the Lutheran Church. I am glad to have this opportunity, and I am honored to introduce my colleagues. We have Mr. Mungu Atosha Makao, who is the treasurer of our diocese. We have Mr. Samuel Wado, who is the general manager of our bank, Uchumi Commercial Bank.
Thank you for that introduction. And Mungu Atosha and Samuel, nice to meet you today as well. So let me start straight away with the first question, because this is not the first time that your church has done a faith plan. You have been on this journey for many years. And I'd like to ask you, Bishop Shu and Samuel in particular, how did you create the very first plan that led to the setup of Uchumi Bank? which is a church-owned bank.
Thank you. The idea of establishing our church-owned bank actually came out of the challenges that our church institutions and church members and parishioners were getting when it came to financial services. It was not very easy for our institutions and people, for example, to get credit. And the conventional banking system was not accommodating to the needs and levels of our people. My predecessor, the then bishop of that time, Dr. Erasto Kweka, presented the idea to the Diocese Executive Council, which gave blessings and directed that a special committee to be established in order to oversee the entire process of registering a bank in Tanzania.
Thank you, Bishop Shu. And perhaps Samuel will want to pick it up from there in terms of how the bank operates today.
Yeah, thank you so much. Just to extend what Bishop has said, the task was to start establishing the initial capital. The requirements for establishing a community bank by then, it was 2005, minimum required capital was Tanzanian shillings 250 million. Therefore, the first thing the committee did is to pass through churches to mobilize the congregation about establishing the bank. So in 2005, September, the bank was able to raise T shillings 372 million as an initial capital. Therefore, the church was granted a license to establish a community bank operating locally within Kilimanjaro region. And on 22nd of September, the bank opened door to the public. So the door was open, people were bringing their deposits, the bank started lending.
Yeah.
Here we are today.
It's a wonderful story. And what's also great about it is that whilst it was started by the church, it's open to those of every faith. Bishop Shu, I would love to ask you a bit more around how you mobilized all the different churches to contribute to this.
Thank you, Nana. The first step was the awareness raising. We had awareness meetings, which were carried out to church members and institutions. But also we gave public education on the importance of saving and credit. And the third step was to mobilize capital from the parishioners themselves, who in turn got bought the shares. And thus individual parishioners and parishes had the sense of ownership. And it was not so easy. There were, of course, resistances. Some of our partners from abroad, for example, with whom we shared this idea of starting a bank, they thought this is impossible, and that we as a church in Tanzania, in Africa, we cannot do that. And they actually discouraged us. Yes. But we persisted. We persisted, and in faith, through faith, we managed to establish such a bank.
Thank you, Bishop Shu. Maybe now I will turn to Mungwatosha as you think about your role as treasurer for the whole diocese. What does it take to have a good plan?
Okay, thank you, Nana. For me, I will say what really makes a good financial institution or financial investment. First of all, we set clear financial goals. To the extent that everybody or members really understand what you want to achieve. And therefore, for us, we shared the goals to the members, and members really understand what was the objectives. Mm-hmm. And this one included the creation of the ownership to the members. For us, we do run our banking professionally and really business oriented, so that the church does not interfere the banking business or operations, but it just operates professionally, making sure that it's an income that will go back to the shareholders as dividends. Therefore, the bank is very transparent, so they can just know how much we earn as a profit and how much goes back to them. And again, we have created the human touch value, the customer care that we give to our people, keeping their dignity, make sure that we keep their confidentiality of everything, but make sure that they receive what they want. And again, we've created the sense of ownership by selling shares to the ordinary people, and therefore they have that sense of ownership on their side.
Thank you, Mangwatosha. As you say, it is about that sense of ownership and the laity being involved. And I might close just asking about what are the plans for the future?
First of all those governors you just mentioned, setting a clear goal, getting understanding for all the congregation, that has created something which is very important to the parishioners, that they feel this is our bank. So whenever they think of financial service, they think of Uchumi. So they put their deposit, they have set the plans that every Sunday when they do the contribution, they set aside some percentage just to top off capital. So what the result is, we started with a capital of 372 million, and currently we have a capital of 10.1 billion. So it's the investment that church has made, it has touched the life of people. Some people previously, they were not even able to enter the banking hall. So they think the bank is for rich people. After the establishing of Uchumi Bank, many people now feel that they can go to the bank, they can borrow, they can do business. So that has created a sense of financial literacy among the community, but also the life changing. We have so many cases where you see someone has started with a very small business. Now they are running a very big portfolio.
Thank you very much, Samuel. And maybe Bishop Shude, what would you say to encourage other groups who are just starting their journey of making faith plans?
By establishing this bank, we have learned one thing, that it does not matter how small you start. You only have to believe in that and to have that good faith and the good intention of improving the people's livelihoods, to improve the economy of the poor families, even in the rural areas, but also in the cities. We have seen that it can be done. And as Samuel has just said, through our bank, we have seen life-changing experiences. And it has really made a difference and an impact, a very positive impact to the people. So it can be done to have this faith and to have the will to help transform the livelihoods of the people, and especially the poor people.
To have the faith and to have the will, it can be done. Thank you all very much indeed for your contributions.
Thank you, Pippa, for playing that video. And I just want to reiterate the point that Bishop Shu made relatively early on and that we closed with. Faith is an important part of this. It's important to plan. It's important to see what you have, to do your asset audit and to put your plans on paper. But faith is also an important element of how groups have made the commitments, gone ahead in faith, and actually been able to do really substantial and significant and important things with the assets that they own and control. So very grateful to Bishop Shu and his team for that video. And we now open the floor and welcome James Buchanan from Operation Noah to come and join us and talk a bit about the work that they have been doing with churches in the UK. So James.
Hi, Nana. And thanks to the team at Faith Invest for inviting us to share something with you today. So my name is James Buchanan. I'm the Bright Now campaign director at Operation Noah. And I've got a couple of my colleagues here with me as well. Bakani Chidsu, who's also working particularly on fossil fuel divestment as well. We have a couple of new, fairly new staff members. Julia Corcoran, who's focusing on sort of positive investment with different churches in the UK. And then Sharon Hall, who's focusing on Church of England land use. So I'm sure we'll have opportunities to share more about those things later. So I, as I said, I work on Operation Noah's Right Now campaign, which encourages UK churches to divest or disinvest from fossil fuel companies, to invest in climate solutions such as renewable energy. And another element, as I've just mentioned, that we're also focusing on is encouraging the Church of England to consider its land use and, for example, the tree coverage on its land and so on. So as I said, we're a UK Christian climate charity. While we're UK focused, I would say that we collaborate globally with different partners, and we're delighted to be collaborating with Faith Invest on the faith plans and also on the investment side as well. In terms of our work, I would say that we're probably best known as an organisation for our work on fossil fuel divestment. It's something that we've been campaigning on with our Bright Now campaign for quite a few years. And it's something that can be done when we're talking about fossil fuel divestment or positive investment. It's something that can be done by faith groups, by churches and other faith groups at all levels. So in this photo here, you can see this is a local Methodist church, Ivy Bridge Methodist Church in Devon, which was the first local Methodist church in the UK to divest from fossil fuel companies back in 2019. And the Methodist church actually at a national level just divested from fossil fuel companies last year. So as you can imagine, in between those times, there was a big campaign that involved a lot of people and that helped to make that change happen. At Operation Noah, we've collaborated with a number of different partners, particularly the Laudato Si movement, which was formerly known as the Global Catholic Climate Movement, World Council of Churches, Green Anglicans and Green Faith. And ahead of COP26, we were involved in organising a global divestment announcement where 72 faith institutions announced their divestment from fossil fuels. And 37 of those organisations were in the UK. Obviously, with COP26 happening in the UK, it was a really great opportunity to really mobilise faith groups around these issues. And as I said, we've collaborated with global partners. And this is a quote from Bishop Ernesto Manuel in northern Mozambique, which was around the time of one of the divestment announcements. He said, "Fossil fuel investments increase climate change and impacts on those most vulnerable and also destabilize communities. We plead with the international community, take your money out of fossil fuels and invest in renewable energy, which is decentralized, benefits local people and does not contribute to climate change." So I guess within what he's saying, there are the two parts of this. There's the obviously with the investments to divest or disinvest from fossil fuels to stop doing harm with our investments, but also the positive investment as well and encouraging groups to increase their investment in renewable energy and in climate solutions. In terms of where we are in the UK on the fossil fuel divestment work, actually most UK churches now in the last few years have divested from fossil fuel companies, as you can see from this slide. Quakers in Britain, you know, as they are on many issues, we're already at the forefront on this. And gradually over time, you can see more and more churches have completed their divestment from fossil fuel companies. And so the main churches that we are still encouraging to divest from fossil fuel companies are the Church of England, both in terms of diocese and nationally, the Catholic Church in England and Wales, and then also the Scottish Episcopal Church as well. And I mentioned about these global divestment announcements that we've organised. The next one will be happening in July this year. So this is something that that faith groups can join, not just Christian organizations. It's something that faith groups from any faith can participate in. And in terms of what groups that join those announcements commit to doing, they confirm, first of all, either that they have divested from fossil fuel investments already, or that they will divest from any investments in fossil fuel companies as soon as possible and within 5 years at the latest. Most groups, I think, find that the process can be done much quicker than that, normally, you know, certainly within a year or two usually. Or thirdly, that they don't hold any fossil fuel investments and make a pledge not to invest in fossil fuels in the future. So, for example, we've worked quite a bit with local churches, some of which have investments, but some of them say, well, we only have a bank account, so we don't have fossil fuel investments. So in that case, making a divestment commitment involves a pledge not to invest in fossil fuel companies in the future. So in that case, if, for example, your faith group were to receive a legacy which had shares in fossil fuel companies, if you had that policy which meant that you wouldn't invest in fossil fuel companies, then you would sell those shares because of the policy. So that's what this commitment would involve. Just to mention on the sort of positive investment side, so this is I would say an area which is slightly newer for us, Operation Noah. It's always been part of our Bright Now campaign, but it is very much part of the campaign and something that we're increasingly focusing on. We helped to organize a webinar before COP26, and at the webinar, Bishop Hugh Nelson, who you can see here, the Bishop of St. Germans in the Diocese of Truro, spoke to us about how the Diocese of Truro had not only divested from fossil fuel companies, but had also started investing positively as well. And he shared that the Diocese of Truro has invested nearly £2 million in funds that are investing directly in renewable energy. So it's a really, really great case study. And I think really that for us was showing prophetic leadership, really, in terms of what, you know, what does it look like for a group, not only obviously to divest, to take that important step, but to also be part of the solution as well. Just to mention a couple of, we've got a number of useful resources. So all of these webinars are available online. So you would find them, some of them on our YouTube channel. You'd also find some of them on the Bright Now website, which is brightnow.org.uk. Going to mention very briefly about a case study from the United Reformed Church, which divested from fossil fuel companies in 2019. So in the United Reformed Church, it's a sort of medium-sized, I would say, UK church. In terms of its total investments, total assets at a national level, it has around £100 million of investments. So about £50 million of investments, which are held by the United Reformed Church at a national level, and then its pension fund, which is a similar size, around £50 million as well. And with a group of members of the United Reformed Church, we at Operation Noah supported those members of the United Reformed Church in a campaign to encourage the United Reformed Church nationally to divest from fossil fuel companies. But in terms of how the campaign started, it really started very much at a sort of local level. So there were some groups that were looking at this with their local churches, some that were looking at it with their local synods, which is a sort of equivalent of diocese, if you're familiar with obviously diocese in different churches. And so there were sort of two or three synods that had divested from fossil fuel companies and brought motions to the church nationally, calling for the United Reformed Church at a national level to divest. This came to a meeting of the United Reformed Church Mission Council in May 2019 and was debated, and the United Reformed Church at that meeting voted to divest. Now, at that point in time, the United Reformed Church's investment managers, CCLA, didn't actually have a fund that was fossil fuel free. So they didn't have a fund which wasn't investing in fossil fuel companies. So the United Reformed Church then approached their fund managers, CCLA, and said, we would like a fossil free fund. We don't want to invest in fossil fuel companies. You know, what can you do for us? And I guess CCLA had three options. They could have said to the United Reformed Church, well, I'm afraid we don't offer one, so you're going to have to look somewhere else. And that was a possibility. But they decided, actually, we want to keep the United Reformed Church as one of our clients. We want them to carry on investing with us. So they had a choice. They could either set up a new fund, or the existing fund which the United Reformed Church was in could become a fossil-free fund. And that's actually what happened. So CCLA decided that their charity's ethical investment fund would become a fossil-free fund. And that fund actually had £900 million of assets under management. So whereas the United Reformed Church nationally had around £100 million of investments, this fund, which actually went fossil-free, had £900 million of investments. So you can see from that really how the decision that United Reformed Church made had a much, much wider impact, not only on its own investments, but also on the wider investments of a number of other faith groups and other charities as well. So I'm going to stop there.
James, thank you so much for taking us through the Bright Now legs of the work, divestment campaign, how far you've come, how much more there is to do, shifting to the positive investment side as well. And really, it's interesting as you look at the case studies of those groups who are committing on the one side and then shifting to the other. It is interesting to see that there are solutions out there, or solutions can be created. If I think about our own work as well, we're starting to see groups come in and say, we have these assets available, and what we're looking to do is to see how can we positively invest them, yes, to support a building project, but also in a way that completely aligns with our faith. That's an example here with one of the Buddhist groups who we work with, or another example with a group based in the States. New people coming into the investment committee and saying, we've never really tried to align. We've understood some of the campaigns going on and we've kind of kept an eye on them, but now it's really time for us to commit. And it's about both the rebalancing what you don't want to support, but getting really positively into what you do want to support. And I would just love to get a sense from, and actually to one add one aspect, the groups who have been doing this for a while and are kind of getting further along the investment campaign side. So where can we do impact investing? We have this amount of money, we've been given a mandate, we've got these very specific terms, where can we actually further align new capital to do new things that wouldn't have been happening anyway? So with all of that preamble, if you think about the broad population of groups who you work with, institutions, dioceses, where do you think they are? And how are you getting them onto that positive climate investment journey and really making those commitments to do good for people and planet with their money?
Yeah, good question, Anna. Well, I suppose we work with churches at all levels, I guess. So I'd say there are some churches, also some national churches, which are already doing some positive investment. So we're aware, for example, we're obviously campaigning on fossil fuel divestment with the Church of England, but we're also aware that at the same time, the Church of England does have some positive investments already in climate solutions. So some of these things are happening also with groups like the Diocese of Truro. I think, in a sense, for us, we see the sort of positive investment side as a natural next step in the journey, if you like. And I think it can be done, you know, it can obviously be done by groups that haven't yet divested from fossil fuel companies. But I think the journey, certainly for us, if there are groups that divest from fossil fuel companies, the journey doesn't end there. I mean, that I think is an important step in terms of do no harm, you know, kind of with the investments, but it's absolutely crucial, as you said, to sort of look at what can we be doing positively with our investments as well. And I think there are more and more of these options out there. I suppose perhaps the first step is often to speak with your existing investment managers and find out, you know, are they already doing some of these positive investments? Because sometimes they are and you're just not aware of it. But then also sometimes it's obviously important to be more proactive and look into that. And I'm aware that's something that, for example, the Quakers did when they divested from fossil fuels. They also proactively spoke to their investment managers and said, we also want to be doing the positive investment as well.
Absolutely. No, James, it's very much a sense. And maybe just to close with one more question to you, as you work with us and other partners and around this Faith Plans initiative, how are you helping to engage groups in creating their faith asset plans? And maybe this is a bit of an on-the-spot question, but it would be good to get an example from how partners, how resource partners in particular, like Operation NOAA, are really helping to mobilize this effort.
So Operation NOAA is a resource partner on the Faith Plans program. And I guess our work is obviously especially focused on the assets. So, you know, obviously the topic of today's workshop. We're working particularly with a group in the Methodist Church, to give just one example, who are working on the faith plan for the Methodist Church, which they've called Action for Hope. This is a Methodist Church in Great Britain. And they've decided to prioritise three areas within their faith plan, one of which is assets. And there are a couple of other areas, lifestyles and wisdom, I think, are a couple of the other areas that they're working on. Obviously, the Methodist Church in Great Britain is a big institution, so they have a number of people who are working on this together. We're working to support a group called the Methodist Zero Carbon Group, who are sort of working to support the faith plan. The Methodist Church in Great Britain has already divested from fossil fuel companies, so we're really, really looking to support. We are supporting with starting to look at the sort of positive investments, as we've said. So, you know, what could the Methodist Church in Great Britain do in terms of increasing their investment in climate solutions? With the Methodist Church, a lot of their investments are managed by the Central Finance Board of the Methodist Church, which manages investments for a lot of, local Methodist churches, the Methodist Church sort of regionally and nationally, and also for a number of other charities and faith groups as well. So we're working to support them. It's been amazing really to see how once the process gets started, perhaps the first step is almost the getting started is almost the hardest part. And once you get into it and look at, you know, what can we do practically, I think it's brilliant to see the enthusiasm among the groups that are working together on this.
Absolutely. James, thank you very much for that. And that's a great segue into the breakout sessions which we'll be holding now. If everyone is more or less back, maybe I might invite the James and Catherine group to share their feedback first, and then we will also feedback on our discussions.
Catherine, do you want to go?
No, you start, James, please.
Okay. There are some interesting questions sort of following on from the presentations. There were a few questions around I think we talked quite a bit about fossil fuel divestment. There are a few questions around that. But there are also some questions, for example, around you know, if a faith group decides to divest from fossil fuel companies, how can they also do the positive investment? And I said, in a sense, it's part of the same process, because, you know, if your faith group has investments with an investment management company and those investments are in fossil fuel companies, you will also want to look at the positive side as well, because you don't want to move the investments twice. So it's worth trying to do that process. And that's why obviously there's a time frame in which this can be done. And it doesn't all need to be done overnight, but it's important to do the research to kind of to look carefully at the investment managers that you're with.
Yeah, I mean, one of the key things that James emphasized was, you know, if a faith organization is aware that it's unethical perhaps to invest in a fossil fuel company, for example, but then they continue investing. And I suppose we came to the conclusion that this is why faith plans exist, because faith plans starts with the faith context, the faith theology, the faith lens, that ethical and value lens. That's the ground from which all decisions, including investment decisions, are made. So I mean, that's what's unique about the Faith Plans program. Really, we had a really good breakout session, and just to thank everyone for joining us, because I'm aware that we were in different places in terms of this conversation. So there were really good, insightful comments, and thanks to James for that.
Just maybe to mention one other thing which has been sent to me in a direct message, which is a good point. One of the other key things was to find out who are the key decision makers in our organizations and how do we influence them, and making sure that we ask the right people the right questions as well.
And I will add as well, actually, that James emphasized that this isn't just about, you know, the kind of the likes of Shell and so on. It's also about your bank and the investment decisions that your bank makes and takes. So there is a kind of another point of advocacy in that piece that perhaps some of us might forget as well.
Thanks very much for that, Catherine. And actually, I'll just pick up on that point before I go into the feedback from our breakout group. One of the working groups that we have, as well as looking at faith consistent investing and impact, is on sustainable banking and that specific issue of customer advocacy. And I don't think we have it on our next steps, but we can circulate to the group when that next session will be, if they want to have further discussions on sustainable banking and how that affects how you invest. We had a really good session as well, many different perspectives and challenges coming through. I think leadership and governance was the theme. So for some, how do you get the leaders on board? How do you get them to really put the faith values at the center? And then how do you work out who controls the assets? Because often the voice for action is influencing one part of the organization, but the assets may be controlled in completely different structure, different managers who aren't necessarily aligned. So that kind of, to what extent can your plan act as a voice and maybe help some alignment there? There were issues around how do you find solutions, and sometimes the ask for solutions is really simple. We just want a plug and play solution. We've even got an idea of what return we want, what kind of categorization we want. So how can faith invest and others help us to find that solution? And for us, it's very much around sharing within the room, but also being efficient around finding what the solutions are, so that once you've made the commitment, you know where to go. There were particular discussions around impact. I think a few different groups in our room were at various stages on that. And just to share again, the challenge of how do you get started was one of the themes that came across. There are groups who have, one who'd made their very first impact investment, who will kind of document how it worked. And one of the things we're also doing with one of our members, Cabrini Sisters, is documenting their first 100 and first 1,000 days in impact investing, to really try and give that step-by-step guide, because we're aware that in this, it's about the granularity. And it's about the getting started that's often the hardest part, but a really good conversation. And also about the importance of documentation, that a lot of faith groups are doing a lot with all of the assets that they have. And often it's only when you go back and try to document and say, what's our starting point, that you get a sense of what already exists, what potential is there. And understanding potential is so important, because for groups, especially groups who've been going from being very supported to now having to be more self-sustainable, sometimes there's a certain reassurance in knowing what you have and what you own and what real assets you have in terms of setting a plan for the future. So I think my main conclusion was that there are many more conversations to be had. And to some extent, there are individual conversations, but to some extent, there are also the collective coming together to see how we can plan and maybe match some of the needs and desires for investment with the opportunities to invest. On that note, I will pass over to Catherine for next steps and wrap up.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Nana. So I realize we have around 10 minutes left. Thank you all for joining us, and thank you for the really excellent and engaging and interesting and informative contributions from Nana and James and Bishop Hsu. Okay, so just in next steps. So if you are not already in the Faith Plans program and you have enjoyed what you've heard this afternoon, and if you're interested, we invite you to visit faithplans.org, and on there you can register your interest in the program. By registering your interest, you will receive our newsletter. You'll find out more information about our events. And then, of course, if you are ready to make your faith plan, you can make your commitment. By making your commitment, you will receive more information on our resources, some of our tools. Registering your interest, you'll also find out a lot more information on how to navigate the process on our website and our resources and tools and so on. So please visit faithplans.org to register your interest, or if you're ready, to make your commitment to develop a faith plan. Also, in terms of next steps, some of you may already be members of Faith Invest, or you can consider to become a member, a visit faithinvest.org. And just to emphasize, so Faith Invest provides a network for faith-based investors. Faith Invest is also a source of education, exchange, and collaboration. It provides a platform for investment ideas, opportunities, and concepts. And then it's a voice for faiths and values-driven investors. So Faith Invest is very much that space. And as Nana pointed out, you know, the importance of individual and collective conversations. And Faith Invest provides that space for those conversations to take place, and very much for that learning and sharing as well. I've already mentioned the Faith Plans Hub. I strongly encourage you to visit our website, and on the website you will find lots of inspiring stories, case studies, how to go about creating your faith plan. I'm aware that that's very much a theme that has come up this afternoon. You know, how do we get started? Where do we start? Very much that daunting process. On the website, you'll find lots of information, resources, case studies, tools, and so on. And in particular, specific to this topic, you'll also find faith-consistent guidelines about how to use your assets in a way that's aligned with your values and beliefs. And we have a lot of resources on the Faith Plans website around that, and on the Faith Invest website as well. And then, as I mentioned in particular, as I've said already, the Faith Plans program is centered on 7 key areas that are quite broad and holistic. And one of those areas are financial assets. We encourage participants to start by downloading our simple planning guide to get them started in the Faith Plans process. We then also invite you to explore our 7 key area framework, and that's on our website. And one of those areas, as I said, is around your financial investments. And we have quite detailed information that you can use. And over the coming week, we will be uploading a downloadable version that you can take and go away and reflect on and so on. On the website, we also have a baseline survey that we're encouraging groups to use as a reflection and an action tool. So that survey is to be used to take stock of what you've already done. It does include questions on your investment policies. So we hope that you'll use that, and that you'll find that of use as well in terms of your faith plan process. So as I mentioned already, Faith Plans runs a program of monthly workshops. We also have a monthly newsletter, and we also run workshops with partner organizations. So just next week, Faith Invest are hosting on the 3rd of March a working group. If you're responsible for your organization's assets and investments and want to find out more, sign up for the Faith Invest membership or join the FCI working group on March 3rd, and all the details are there. On the 30th of March, Faith Plans is partnering with WWF, one of our main partners, and we're looking at faith plans and faith-based tree planting. We also have a number of speakers from UNEP, the United Nations Environmental Programme, the Trillion Trees Programme, and we also have someone joining us from the Anglican Church in South Africa. So that plans to be a very engaging workshop as well. And that's it from us. Thank you very much for joining us. We hope that you found this session of interest and of use. Please get in touch if you've any further questions or comments on the workshop. And we look forward to welcoming you at our next event in a number of weeks. Take care.